So, good afternoon to everyone. Welcome to the second lecture about the world of quantum mechanics and quantum communication networks. Last week we saw the motivation of quantum communication networks and why to apply quantum mechanics to communications and computing. And we also went through the beginning of quantum mechanics. So we saw the initial experiments that were showing why a different behavior at atomic and subatomic scale in respect of classical theories. So given this, this week we will go deeper into the concept, and we will see in more details from between today and tomorrow. The notation that is used now in quantum mechanics and the concept of qubit, so the quantum bit. But first, I want to justify a bit more why you should attend and why is this course maybe interesting for you and valuable for your future career. This slide I show, I also report the link. The Quantum Flagship is the framework in Europe that includes companies, universities, and research institutes that is devoted to research in quantum technologies applied in communication and computing. And you see things that we also mentioned last time. So you see boosting big data, network synchronization, quantum computers, quantum simulation. So, for example, simulations of quantum system of chemical systems are sometimes not possible with quantum supercomputer with classical supercomputer. So you need a quantum computing entity to perform reliably and accurately such simulation. Then you see research on brain metrology, imaging and sensing. So if you are an engineer in ICT or related fields, very likely you will end up in a company that will fall into one of these categories, and once your boss or your company will ask you to go deeper into quantum mechanics and its applications on these fields. So eventually the background that we will have in this module will give you an additional help to answer to the challenges that your future career will pose to you. So also imagine you will start to look into the news. As I said also last time, our course, the doesn't want to be an exhaustive presentation of quantum mechanics and quantum communication and quantum communication networks related fields, but wants to allow you to understand even the news that you can find in the internet or in the newspapers. So, for example, this is one example that I extracted about Google, as I said, related to chemistry simulation. For example, you see that in the article you can have terminology like quantum bits, qubits. So imagine you are a newcomer and you want to understand and read this article. In the text you find the term quantum bits, qubits, and you should know what is a quantum bit, what is the characteristic of a quantum bit in respect of a normal bit. So this is also, for example, I also extracted text from this news in the internet, and you can see, for example, IBM promises 1,000 qubit quantum computer by 2023. So what does this mean? So the idea is that after this few lectures that we will have together, you will be able to read an article about the field, even a high-level magazine or blog article, and you will be able at least to know what they are saying. So here I reported the definition of quantum bit, also called the qubit, from one of the oldest and most renowned encyclopedias in the world, that before was only books, now is only virtual, only online. So Britannica, the Encyclopedia Britannica, and if you read, considering what we have already mentioned in the last lecture, you see, for example, that a traditional digital computer employs binary digits or bits. In contrast, the quantum bit or qubit exists in a wave-like superposition. So we start understanding already that there is an interconnection, a logical interconnection, a logical link between the concept of quantum bit, qubit, and the concept of wave function. So what we discussed in the last lecture, what we introduced in the last lecture, and also the coexistence of a dual behavior, like particle and wave-like behavior, for a quantum system expressed by the quantum wave function. So today and tomorrow, as I said, we will focus on the concept of we want to target this week the concepts of spin, qubit, their connection with the concept of wave function, and connecting also to the description of quantum measurement that we will see fully next week together with the concept of entanglement. This week, between today and tomorrow, we will also spend some time to introduce, if you remember what we discussed last lecture, we said that at the beginning there were two notations, wave mechanics and another one expressed in terms of matrices. These two notations, mathematical notations, were two separate notations, but during the course of the last century, these two notations were demonstrated to be equal. And what was formulated by mainly Dirac and von Neumann was the annotation for a unified annotation for quantum mechanics based on Hilbert spaces and group theory and geometry. So between today and tomorrow we will try to achieve the formulation, the main characteristics of Dirac notation and formulation, and with this achieving a description, an accurate description of what is a qubit from the spin and connecting to wave function and measurement. So, but anyway, let's rewind a bit, because today especially the lecture will be a recap from eventually other courses that you had, for example, geometry, linear algebra. However, eventually today I will mention some concepts and some elements that you have never seen. So depending your previous path of studies. So in the way that after this lecture we will be all synchronized, and in the next ones I will be able to refer to the concepts that I will show you today. So today it will be a recap if you have already heard these concepts, so a refresh. Otherwise it will be useful to get the background in order to understand what I will present from tomorrow and the other lectures. So let's start from the concepts and the definitions related to symmetry groups. So if we consider a square defined in the complex plane, we can see, if we talk about symmetries, we can see that there are two possibilities of symmetries. One is the group of those symmetries that are called rotational, so they are not reflective, so they involve just rotation of the square, rotations of the square. And then there are other symmetries that are reversing the orientation of the square, so are reflections of this square, and they turn the square in respect of axis. So let's start, for example, from non-reflective rotations. So if you see the number of rotations that we can apply without reflections, the number of rotations that we can apply to this square are mainly four. So, and these four rotations can be identified by the complex values, the complex numbers, 1i, minus 1, and minus i. So the total number of rotations results to be 4. Then, if you see, you can, if you consider the definition that you saw, for example, in courses about algebra, you can demonstrate, you can prove by your own that this set of elements, the definition of a group is done generally, considering a general binary operation. But if we consider that this binary operation is a multiplication, then we can see that the group, the finite group of these four elements, the finite set of these four elements identifies an algebraic structure called group. So the group axioms are satisfied. Moreover, it is possible to see that this specific finite group is also commutative. So, in this sense, the group is also called Abelian, from the Norwegian mathematician Abel. Then, we can now consider reflections. So in the complex plane, a reflection can be seen as an operation called the complex conjugate. So if we now try to reflect this square, we see that there are four possible ways of reflections. So there are two perpendicular flips, so one horizontal and one vertical, and two diagonal ones. And if the multiplication laws for this group are these ones, and you can verify by your own, it's relatively simple, you can verify by your own that by applying these equalities, the two members, the two rotations result to be equal. For example, if you apply first a rotation I on the square, so this kind of rotation, 90 degrees, and then you apply the complex conjugate on the different points, on the various points of the square, this is the same of first applying the complex conjugate and then multiplying, applying a negative rotation minus I. So this you can verify it by your own. The only thing that we have to note is that now this group is not abelian. And in terms of terminology, the number of distinct elements of the group is called the order of the group. So if we consider the overall number of symmetries that the square can have, we see that this group is of order 8. So there are 8 elements. However, since we saw, for example, that for some of these elements, the commutative property is not satisfied, this group, the overall group of 8 members, is not abelian. So now we extend our analysis, our discussion, and we go to the 3 dimensions. So we consider a sphere. So if we consider the possible rotations, as before, we consider before rotations, non-reflective, and then we consider also reflective. So if we first consider the non-reflective symmetries, we see that the sphere can be rotated in an infinite number of ways. So what you obtain is overall a 3-dimensional space that can be represented by a 3-manifold in R. And this this group identified by the 3-dimensional space is called normally in the terminology SO3. So S means special. So means that we will see later, but all the matrices in this group have determinant 1, and O means orthogonal. We will also see this one in the course of the lecture. And 3 is the dimension. So now we are in 3-dimension. So this is the meaning of SO3. So then if we include the reflections, we have another 3-manifold that is disconnected by the other one. So they are not connected. And so if we put everything together as we did before for the square, we have the overall group, the entire group space that is called O3. So what we can see is that in respect of the previous one, this one is called represents a continuous group, because we don't have a finite number of elements, and these continuous groups are also called Lie groups. We will see we will mention these Lie groups tomorrow, but I will not go into details because it's not in the scope of this course, of this module of a course, to teach, to go into the details of group theory and group geometry. So for both finite and continuous groups, as probably you have already seen in other courses in the last years, you can define the notion of a subgroup. So if there are subsets of groups that satisfy themselves the group axioms, these subsets can be called subgroups. So, and we can see here some of subgroups of the groups that we have defined before. So, for example, the 4-element subgroup of all the rotational symmetries. so without reflections. And this subgroup is abelian, as we said, while the other one is not. Then we have the other reflective ones. Then these two elements are another, you can verify, are another subgroup. Then if we go, for example, to the example of the sphere of continuous groups, we see that non-reflective rotation group SO3 is a subgroup. But the other one not. Why this? Because if we come back, if we go back to the previous slide or to the group axioms, you see that you need an identity element. This is one of the axioms that that define an entity to be a group, a set to be a group. So we see that only SO3 has the identity. In the other one, you don't have the identity. So in the reflective symmetries, so only this one can be a subgroup of O3. So then we go to the concept of subgroups, of normal groups. So imagine that we have a subgroup S of G. So if we select an element of G, then we can have post multiplication. So normally is G multiplied by the elements of the subgroup. And what you have to consider is that the elements of this subgroup S, if we consider this one as an example, the symmetry group of the square, for example, are not an ordered set, so we can take them in different orders. The important thing is the structure, so the elements themselves, and not their position. So if we choose, for example, the element of the group I, we can verify that we can calculate the post-multiplication and the pre-multiplication. So we take the element, the set of the subgroup, we multiply it by G, by this element, individual element, and we see that the condition, we verify the condition for the subgroup to be a normal subgroup, so that the post-multiplication and the pre-multiplication are equal for all G in S. So in the case, for example, of O3, this equality is verified for the subgroup SO3. So now let's move to refresh some concepts of linear transformations and matrices, and see the difference between linear transformation and matrices. So if we consider a linear transformations, so the groups of symmetries that we have seen can be expressed by linear, so-called linear transformations. That what is the objective of linear transformation, the characteristic, the main characteristic of linear transformation. The main characteristic is that they preserve the structure of the vector space. So they don't change the structure of the vector space. So if we have a vector space, and in the definition of vector space, we have the notion also of addition, multiplication on a field, considering a given field, then, for example, the addition, we know that, we all know that if we have the addition of two vectors, this addition, the result is given by the parallelogram law, and the multiplication of a vector by a scalar. So if we have a vector v, multiplying the vector by a scalar lambda, we obtain this longer vector lambda v. So we have the multiplication, the addition of vectors. We have the multiplication of a vector between a vector and a scalar on the finite field. And we can extend these concepts to the vector, to a complex vector space. So the field, the finite field, the field is not anymore a real field, but is a complex field. So then, as I said, linear transformations of V takes V to itself. So it preserves the structure of the vector space. So if we contextualize the concept of linear transformation by having a specific space and the concept of basis, we can say that the linear transformation is described by an array of numbers that we normally called a matrix. So here we see, for example, we connect again to the group, the rotation groups of the sphere. So if we consider these rotations, we embed them in the Euclidean tree space. So now we have a vector space with coordinates and defined by orthogonal basis, a set of basis. We can see, we can refer to the symmetries of the sphere represented by a sphere of a vector space with respect to the origin at the sphere center, so represented by the locus defined by this relation that you have seen probably many times in also other courses. And these three coordinates are the Cartesian coordinates. So these rotations, as I said before, are overall group and in the special subgroup SO3. And this, for example, the orthogonal group O3 consists of all the linear transformation that preserve the unit sphere. So this is important, as I said, for linear transformations, is to preserve the characteristics of the sphere, of this unit sphere. Otherwise, for example, if we consider general linear transformations, not the orthogonal ones we saw before, what can happen is that the structure of the sphere can be modified. So the sphere is not anymore, the transformation are not anymore isotropic, so they don't preserve the uniformity in all the orientations as before, but they become anisotropic. So in some directions, the structure of the sphere can be not preserved. So normally, when we have linear transformations, it means that we express the new coordinates as linear combinations of the original ones. So we have expressions representing linear combinations of the three previous coordinates given some constant numbers. So if we have three coordinates as in the three Euclidean space, we have a linear transformation, a general linear transformation that can be expressed in this way. So given as a product between the matrix T of the transformation and the original coordinates. So the new coordinates become the product of matrix and vector. So this can also be written concisely in a vector matrix form without considering the components. So if we apply, for example, two transformations in a row, so first the transformation T and second the transformation S, what we have is that the overall transformation is the product of both. Then we have also the identity, linear transformation, and this identity is normally written in terms of the famous Kronecker delta that probably you have seen. Very likely you have seen also in other courses about linear algebra and geometry. That can be defined in this way. So then the linear transformation that can eventually map the entire vector space to a specific region that is a subspace of the original vector space of smaller dimension. Then these linear transformations are called singular. So an equivalent condition of this is that if exists a non-zero vector V and we multiply the matrix representing the linear transformation by this vector V and we obtain the zero, then this is singular. So if the transformation on the other hand is non-singular, then what happens is that the transformation T has an inverse. So the matrix T has an inverse. And we can see that the product between the matrix and the inverse gives the identity linear transformation, so the identity matrix. So If we restrict the attention to square matrices given a fixed n, so n times n matrices, we have a system in which the notions of addition and multiplications are defined according to standard algebraic laws, and this standard algebraic laws hold. So it is possible to define the normal notions of addition and multiplications for these squared matrices. However, an important thing that we have in matrix algebra in respect of other algebras is that the commutative law for multiplications for the multiplication is not always satisfied. So this is not always true. And also the fact of having a matrix, an inverse matrix, is not always true as well. So these are important characteristics of matrix algebra. So now we recall some important concepts that are called determinants, traces, eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Eigenvalues and eigenvectors, we have already mentioned something in the last lecture, but here we will see a bit more extensively. So let's start from the concepts of determinant and trace. So the determinant is a value, is an operation that results in a value, in a scalar, that given a square matrix, we obtain a specific number. There are different ways according to the size n of the number n of related to the size of the matrix, but an important property that we always have for the determinant is this one related to the multiplication of a matrix. On the other hand, side by side, we have the trace of a matrix that is defined. The trace we will see is very important in quantum mechanics, and we will use it a lot in the next lectures. So the trace is normally defined as the sum of the diagonal elements of a matrix. So the property of the trace is, let's say, specular to the one of the determinant, but for the addition instead of the multiplication. So the trace of the sum of two matrices is the trace of the two separate, the matrices singularly. So are determinant and trace connected concepts somehow? Yes, because if we define, for example, infinitesimal linear transformations of square matrices, so we consider an infinitesimal quantity epsilon in which we can ignore the higher powers, so the square and the higher powers, then the determinant of this infinitesimal linear transformation is equal to 1 plus epsilon the trace of the matrix A. So if we extend this one to non-infinitesimal, so to finite linear transformations, then we obtain that the determinant of the exponential of the matrix A is equal to the exponential of the trace A, and it is possible to calculate them using a sort of Taylor series development of the exponential also for matrix forms. So here we present the concepts, we recall again the concepts of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. These two concepts we saw already in the last lecture when we defined, here I reported what we saw, for example, for the momentum of the wave function. So if we have a linear operator in the real world, let's say, if we have a linear operator T, its eigenvector is a vector that satisfies this equation, this relation, and the scalar sigma is called its eigenvalue. So if V is an eigenvector, then is also any non-zero complex multiple of V. So the complex one-dimensional space of these multiples remains unchanged by the linear transformation. So if we have an eigenvector of a linear transformation T and this vector is a complex and non-zero, transforms T into a multiple of itself. So if we have if a complex number exists z, this is called the eigenvalue and satisfied this in the complex world. So this relation, as we see, is connected and gives some terminology to quantum mechanics, as we saw in the previous lecture, so that the wave function is the state vector and is also called the eigen function if it satisfies this relation. And this state vector is we apply a linear transformation using the quantum momentum operator, for example, and we obtain the eigenvalue that is the scalar. So this this relation can be rewritten in this form, and this form gives a polynomial equation of degree n in the variable z. So this z polynomial can be factorized, and all the complex numbers z1, zn are called the eigenvalues. And these eigenvalues can have multiplicity, so can appear not once as solutions of this polynomial equation. In this sense, they have multiplicity m. If we will see, for example, that matrices that are used a lot, that we will see, that are used a lot in quantum mechanics, are called unitary matrices, Hermitian and normal matrices. These matrices normally achieves the maximum dimensionality D equal to R. And moreover, in terms of terminology, the multiplicity of the eigenvalue is also called, is referred to degeneracies. Then we go to the notion of what is a basis. So if we have an n-dimensional vector space, we have an ordered set of vectors, of n vectors, and this, so the number of vectors of basis is the same of the size of the vector space, and these vectors are linearly independent. So there is no relation that can be that is can be written in this form for the basis. So every element, the property of the basis is that every element of V of the vector space can be written as a linear combination of the basis elements. So in this way, considering the components of the n-dimensional vector in the vector space. So if we have a non-singular linear transformation, as we saw before the definition of non-singular, we can send always a basis to another basis. So the linear transformation does is that it changes a basis into a corresponding one. So here we notice what I mentioned before, that the conceptual difference between a linear transformation and a matrix is that the matrix as a basis dependent presentation. So when you define a matrix in a space, you have a basis before you define basis. For linear transformation, there is not this dependency. So the concept is more abstract. Okay, so now we will move to the definition of orthogonal and unitary groups. In order to define the concepts that we are going to describe in the next slides, now I want to introduce a bit to you a specific notation that simplifies the descriptions in n dimension when you want to generalize to n dimensions, having the description in terms of indices and components of vectors and matrices is not all, and tensors in n dimension is not always good to have the indices related to these components. So what is normally sometimes useful in mathematics and in physics sometimes is the so-called abstract index notation that was defined, for example, by Einstein, was used by Einstein also when in the definition of the relativity. So the abstract index notation is mathematical notation that is used for tensors and other entities in which the indices, for example, that we see here, are not, as I said, related to the components, but their position and their characteristic define the type of the entity, rather than the specific components in a particular basis. So now we want to generalize. We don't want to take care about bases and components. So we use these abstract indices. For example, I will give you just a brief description characteristic of these indices, just for the scope of this lecture. This doesn't want to be like an exhaustive description, but for example, a normal column vector has this kind of index, can be defined in this way. This is a vector. Then its covector, its row vector, is defined by this, in this way. Covector. Okay. So if we want to define, for example, the scalar product, the scalar product can be written in this way. Then the matrix vector multiplication matrix vector multiplication can be defined in this way. Then the matrix multiplication we have the matrix multiplication we have the result a matrix of this kind. And then we have the outer product that is defined in this way. Okay. So these are just some representations in the abstract index index notation. So if we go back, for example, to what we have said before about we want to represent the locus of the sphere in this abstract notation, we can see that we can write this relation of the sphere into this form. And what is this GAB? This is a tensor that is not normally called metric tensor. Metric tensor. And this metric tensor is defined is a general entity that defines the relation that there is between an element of length that is called ds and the elements, the increments of the coordinates on a line. So the elements of length is defined in general with the multiplication by the metric tensor and the for example the two. So what we obtain, for example, in our case here, is that if we consider the Euclidean three space, the Euclidean space referred to a Cartesian system, we have the simplification that this metric tensor becomes equal to the Kronecker delta. But this is not true in general, it's true only because we have an Euclidean space, an Euclidean-like space. So we have that this metric tensor is 1 if A equal to B and 0 otherwise. So according to this form of GAB and this relation, you can verify that you can obtain you still obtain this in terms of x1, x2, x3 or n-dimensional Euclidean space. So let's move on. If we have before we mentioned the we make now another extension. Another generalization. For example, before we had the group O3 of the rotation, so the rotation group. O3 meant in the real, so O3 normally ON R, so considering the real number. Now we extend this to the complex field, so we consider general rotations in the complex field, considering complex numbers. And also the coordinates that we have in the relations have complex elements. So if for the moment we consider again the real one, if I don't put it, it means that I consider the real one by now. For simplicity. So the O3 in the real form, we have the quadratic form. The quadratic form is defined in the abstract index notation in this way, and in the matrix tensor matrix vector notation in this way. So we start mentioning the concept in the complex on the complex fields. If we have a complex linear transformation, the concept of unitary group, and the unitary group preserves not the quadratic form, that is this one, but a so-called Hermitian form. This Hermitian form, now we will see the objective of the rest of the slides will be to see what is this Hermitian form. And this Hermitian form and the connected related concepts are fundamental pillars of quantum mechanics and the notation of quantum mechanics in terms of operators on complex fields, complex vector spaces like Hilbert spaces. So if we consider again the quadratic form in X, we can also write the quadratic form is a form that produces a polynomial with terms that are all of degree 2 because of that quadratic form. So if we write if X and Y vectors are different, are not the same, we obtain the symmetric, we have the more general symmetric bilinear form. That is a bilinear, this one is a bilinear map that that from a composite vector space, for example, two vector space V times V, goes to a fields to the field of scalars. But if we put, for example, X equal to Y, we obtain, as I said, the quadratic form. And we have a symmetry for G, that G XY is equal to G YX. So, and moreover, we have linearity. So, two important properties in the second variable. So, we have symmetry and linearity in the second variable, and considering the addition of a vector and the multiplication of a scalar. So if now we move, let me see, for example, let me clarify one thing that I forgot. Here, as I said, G is a tensor, so let me clarify this terminology of 2-0 tensor. So normally a tensor is defined by two indices, P and Q. So if we define a tensor PQ, if we have a tensor that is 2-0, means that we have two indices here in the lower part and zero indices in the upper part. So they are, let's say, inverted in the you can consider that they are inverted in the abstract notation. So this is a matrix. If you have other indices, then the tensor is multilinear. This becomes a multilinear tensor, and the tensor Q, for example, has indices on top, top indices, upper indices, and lower indices. So these ones are Q indices, these ones are P indices, and both they have to be greater and equal from zeros. So this just to have clear the notation. So if now we move to the complex field, so we said that the unitary group preserves the Hermitian form. So what is this Hermitian form that we write here as x, h of x and y? So this Hermitian form satisfies the Hermitian symmetry. So the Hermitian symmetry now considers we are in the complex domain, and we have also the operation of complex conjugate. So the symmetry includes the complex conjugate, if we compare it to the one before. Then we have again the linearity in the second variable. And what is important also in the Hermitian symmetry is called antilinearity in the first variable. So you see here the antilinearity that the scalar becomes the complex conjugate in the first variable in respect of the second one. So if we have an orthogonal group now, normally in the real form, the orthogonal group preserves the symmetric bilinear form. While if we have a complex linear transformation, they preserve the non-singular Hermitian form. So this Hermitian form. And then we have a unitary group. So why this form is important for us? So G provides us a way to identify the vector space V to which X and Y belong, and to connect this vector space to its dual space. So it's important now to identify what this dual space is in terms of when we use this Hermitian form in quantum mechanics. So normally a dual space given a real or complex vector space, the dual is the homomorphism and is defined if you have a field and a vector space, normally the linear maps are homomorphism, so the dual space is called normally homomorphism of the vector space given the field. So the homomorphism is a structure preserving map between the two algebraic structures, so the two vector space of the same type. So the thing is, if the vector belong to the vector space, then the function G on the vector V provides a linear map on the vector space, which maps each element x to the overall number, the full number g dv x. So g dv is an element of the dual space. So if we consider, if we want to write this in the abstract index form, for example, we obtain that the element of the dual space can be written is this covector. And the good thing of using the abstract index form is that you see here the indices delete, and you see that this, for example, there is this A here, these A's are simplified, and you remain with the lower B that you have here. And you see, for example, the inverse of this operation, considering the tensor now GAB, and you have that B and B are simplified. And here I think I should have this one is not 2, 0, but is 0, 2, because not down, are upper indices. So here you get the B simplified, and you remain with the upper A. So now we see this in the Hermitian case. So we have antilinearity that we saw before. This means, so the equivalently, we can say, because of this antilinearity, so we can say that the Hermitian form is linear in the complex conjugate space, let's say, of V. The complex conjugate vectors, as I said, they constitute another vector space. This we will see tomorrow when we present the Dirac notation. We will see it graphically better, this one. So now in the abstract index notation, because we are in the complex domain, we introduce the primed indices. And these prime indices are complex conjugate elements. So, and we have to think that contractions between primed and unprimed indices are not possible, because one is complex conjugate elements. So now the operation of complex conjugation is simply represented by prime, by the interchanges of a prime and unprimed. So if we represent the Hermitian form in terms of abstract indices, and we see that the property of hermeticity is the symmetry that we previously represented, the anti-symmetry, the symmetry with the complex conjugate, the Hermitian symmetry in this form, then these quantities allows us to raise or lower indices as we were doing, so changes from vector space to the dual covector spaces, and as we were doing with the G tensor, but now we'll do it in the complex domain. And what happens now? You see here that the primed indices are simplified and it remains the complex conjugate with the lower B index. Here you have also the simplification, you remain with the prime the index. So for the inverses of these operations, we need obviously to assume that the Hermitian form is non-singular. So as we said before, non-singular, so we have an inverse. So we should have also the inverse of the Hermitian form, obtaining the Kronecker delta tensor. So these ones are the identities, the identity mapping, just written in our simple abstract index form, and from which we can also obtain these relations for the covector between vectors and covectors. So we see also here that the B is simplified and you remain with A prime, and here B prime is simplified and you remain with the upper A. So in the real form we add this to lower and to make to move indices from up and down. So this were the transformations to move from the vector space to the dual. So what happens? All the prime indices can be eliminated using the Hermitian form or its inverse. So and this can be applied index by index to any tensor quantity. So what we see is that the complex conjugate in the formulas that we saw with the abstract form are identified, the complex conjugate space is identified with the dual space. And this is important to define the concept of Hermitian conjugation. So in quantum mechanics, when this Hermitian conjugation is normally defined either via a dagger or an asterisk. We will use the asterisk because there is this, they are synonyms, let's say, because there is there is a coincidence between the dual and the complex conjugate spaces. So here we see what I have just said is just a repetition of what I have just said. So if we have a tensor of valence, this is called the valence PQ. If we apply the dual, becomes the valence QP. So is a switch of indices position in the abstract form. And an abstract index form. So now we see that the operation of complex conjugation and duality are the same. So if we apply this to scalars, we obtain the complex conjugate. If we apply this operation to the Hermitian, considering the equivalent notion of Hermitian form, two matrices, we obtain, for example, in the 2 times 2 case, the conjugate transpose of the matrix. So here you see the matrix in 2 times 2 case. We apply the Hermitian conjugation and we obtain the complex conjugate of the transpose matrix. So here you see that the matrix has been transposed and all the elements are complex conjugates. So the Hermitian matrix is a matrix that is equal to its Hermitian conjugate. So this operation is antilinear. So here I put the properties for completeness of this operation when it's applied to tensor T and U, considering a complex number Z for the multiplication. Then if we have like tensors, multilinear tensors that have upper and lower indices, this is what happens. So the operation of Hermitian conjugation switches the order of the in the product. And then we can now define what is the Hermitian scalar product, that this Hermitian scalar product we will see is fundamental in the definition of a Hilbert space that we will see tomorrow for the definition, for the Dirac notation in order to define a qubit. So the Hermitian scalar product is a scalar product. This one is the notation for a scalar product that is defined by this in the Hermitian form. And we have the complex conjugation, the antilinearity here. So if we consider that the two vectors are equal, then we have the notion of norm. So the scalar product with the vector with itself. And we can now also choose a basis for the vector space. And this vector space is simply the components are we consider the components of the Hermitian, we apply the Hermitian form on the basis, and we obtain the condition of the scalar product between the bases, so that we can have the basis can be called the pseudo-orthonormal. Now we can have the case in which the scalar product is zero or minus or plus one. These are called the pseudo orthonormal. Or in the case in which the signs are just plus one and not plus or minus, plus and minus, the basis is orthonormal. So now we can define unitary transformations and unitary matrices that are the last concept that we see today. So this is important. I will show you why this concept is important in quantum mechanics. In the last slide I will show you. So if we have a pseudo orthonormal basis, then we have we consider that the matrix, the Hermitian matrix in this form is diagonal, and we saw that there are plus and minus ones down the diagonal. So there are P ones and Q minus ones. So the signature, the notion of signature, is this set PQ. And this notion is invariant for the operation of duality and complex and Hermitian conjugation. So if Q is equal to zero, then we say that the operation of duality is positive definite. So in this case, the norm of any non-zero vector is always positive. So a linear transformation whose inverse is the dual, the Hermitian conjugate, then is called unitary. So this is the definition of unitary. Otherwise, if this is positive definite, as we have just said, otherwise it's called pseudo-unitary. So the term unitary matrix refers to the matrix T that satisfies this relation. And when the operation stands for the usual conjugate transpose operation that is defined here. So a group of unitary transformations in n dimension, so when you have n times n unitary matrices, is called a unitary group. Okay, so today we had this excursus on symmetries, symmetry groups. We saw the connection between linear transformation and matrices, what is the difference, what they are connected to symmetries. Then we saw the role of determinants and traces, their interconnection. Then we saw what is we refreshed, what is an eigenvalue, what is an eigenvector. Then I introduced this abstract index form that we used to simplify the general definition of unitary groups, Hermitian form. So in n dimensions, and important for our future discussion was the demonstration, seeing that there is a coincidence between the dual space and the conjugate space, and this represented by the Hermitian conjugation. Then we saw what is the orthonormality, the signature, and what is a unitary group, a unitary matrix. So finally, what I want just to introduce for tomorrow is just to show you a first interconnection between what we said today, that was very theoretical. So you may think that we are out of the topics, but you will see that from tomorrow, all the definitions that I conveyed to you, that I have conveyed to you today, we will find them in the terminology and in the concepts of quantum mechanics and application to quantum computing and quantum computation. So, for example, if we come back to the Schrödinger equation and the concept of quantum measurement. So we said that in the last lecture, we have the quantum system, the states of the quantum system are fully represented by the state vector called also wave function. And the Schrödinger equation represents the evolution in time of this quantum system, isolated quantum system, so a single particle without any interaction from outside or interaction with other quantum systems. So the measurement corresponds to an Hermitian operator, so the quantum measurement is represented by an Hermitian operator. And the result of this measurement is the state, so the state vector, the wave function, falling, moving to an eigenstate of this operator. So the choice, and here is the probabilistic characteristic that eventually you have heard about quantum mechanics. So the result that you have from this Hermitian operator, so from this quantum measurement, is the eigenstate that you get is a matter of probability. So you can get an eigenstate or another one with some probabilities, different probabilities. Then the jump of the operator to this operator, Hermitian operator, to the eigenstates is called the state vector reduction or collapse of the wave function. So we see, for example, in this picture, that we have in quantum mechanics two possible states that are completely different conceptually and like binary in completely different, and the jump, the passage between one state to another one, so the evolution in time and the measurement is immediate. And this probably is still unknown, but this probably because there is not a unique theory yet that connects quantum mechanics, relativity, so this quest in the scientific world that you see to find a unification theory, for example the string theory that you eventually have heard in the books or in the news, is targeting this unification. So at the moment in quantum mechanics you have the unitary evolution, and you see unitary evolution of Schrödinger represented by Schrödinger equation, and then you have the measurement, so the collapse of the state vector reduction or the collapse of the wave function to a specific eigenstate with some probability. Then you have again the isolated system evolving in time, then you measure it and you have another collapse, another with some probability. So this we will see tomorrow, but now you start seeing why the terminology of Hermitian operators, unitary matrices, unitary evolutions, why were so important to be introduced today with the terms of eigenstates, linear transformations.